So welcome students in this particular session. In this class, we would be now getting into the OECD Model Convention and its substantive provisions. In the last lecture, what we had seen was the preamble. We had seen how useful preamble is in interpretation. We had also seen how the courts have somewhere resorted to preamble to get the intention of the treaty. Somewhere they have not resorted to because the preamble does not depict the clear intention of the article. It says some general wordings, but it doesn't show the article's intention, and thereby the courts have rejected it. From Indian perspective, we had seen that courts have resorted to preamble in Azadi Bachao. We had also seen the MLI changes which have happened and how it will going to impact in the near future with relating to double non-taxation. Now, moving ahead in today's class, we would be starting with the substantive provisions of OECD Model Convention. Now, let's start with Article 1. We will be going now article by article wise basis, and let's start with Article 1 of OECD Model Tax Convention. I'll take you to the provision. What does it say? Scope of the convention. Article 1, persons covered. Like every act, if you see, there they would be giving that what is the scope of this particular convention or what is the scope of this particular act, to whom this act will really apply. Similarly, under DTAA also, we have this scope whereby it says clearly in Article 1 that who is covered by this particular convention. As I had said in the very first case, that in the very first class, that income tax or the direct taxes is on the person who is earning the income, right? Unlike indirect tax, where it is being consumed, the income tax speaks about who is earning the income. So under income tax, the charge or the subject is on the person who is earning the income. That is why under the convention, it will apply to the persons who are covered by the convention. And whom it is covering, whom the convention will apply, is described under Article 1. Like our Section 1 of Income Tax Act, where the what is the scope of Income Tax Act is being defined. Similarly, the Article 1 talks about the coverage of this particular convention. So let's see what does it clearly say. Article 1 says the convention or this convention shall apply to persons who are residents of one or both of the contracting states. Now let's dissect this particular definition. So Article 1 persons covered. First paragraph. This convention as in this DTAA, shall apply to persons. So the first condition is that the taxpayer should fall within the definition of persons who are residents of one or both of the contracting states. Residents of either one or of the both. Now, why does it say that residents of one or both? It should be the case that he should be resident of one state, because otherwise how there would be a source and residence taxation conflict? Because as I had told you in the earlier lecture, that DTAA only resolves that source and residence double taxation which happens, right? It really doesn't get into residence double taxation, which is kind of economic double taxation. So how we are dealing with like resident of one or both of the contracting states, the question you should be now thinking about it, right? So the point is that I had told you that DTAA also resolves double taxation resulting due to dual residency. So in some cases, there are cases where residence conflict is also catered by DTAA. One is dual residency, then we had also seen transfer pricing, we had also seen fiscally transparent entity, which we will be dealing now in this particular class. So a person can be resident of one or both of the contracting state. So this convention shall apply to persons who are residence of one or both of the contracting states. Now you would say, the title of the article says persons covered, but it doesn't really define persons. So who are the persons who are covered by this DDAA? Whether it's individual, whether it's a company or a partnership firm or a limited liability corporations, who are the persons? So persons are defined under Article 3. If you would see, we would be dealing with in greater detail in the coming classes, but time being, I'm just referring to the definition of persons who are defined. The term person includes an individual, a company, and any other body of persons. So this is the general definitions under Article 3.1a, where the persons are defined. So person, the definition would be as per Article 3.1a. So now this term is defined under the convention, under the DTAA itself. So we would not resort to the domestic tax law meaning of persons, because under our Income Tax Act also, of course, the persons would be defined, right? So under our Income Tax Act, if you see, the term person is always defined to whom the, who is the taxpayer, basically who is the assessee under the Income Tax Act. So there the definition of person also is given. So do we have to refer to that definition? Answer is no. Because that term is defined under under the Double Tax Avoidance Agreement. But we would see how the differences in interpretation arises though the term is defined under the DTAA. Okay, so we do not have to resort to the definition of persons under Act. Then comes the term residence. Now residence also, if you see, Article 4 defines it. Article 4 defines the term resident. Okay, so this is as per Article 4. So only when a particular person who is resident of either of the states or both of the states, only then the treaty will apply. If either that particular taxpayer doesn't classify as person under the DTAA, or he does not classify as resident, he cannot get the benefit of Double Tax Avoidance Agreement. Clear? So this is the primary principle. Now, after, so this was the DTAA Article 1 or OECD Model Tax Convention Article 1, I should say, up till or before 2017. In 2017, OECD added two more clauses under Article 1. We shall be dealing with now those in detail to understand why these two particular clauses were added under this OECD model update of 2017. Let's look at it and then let's try to understand what were the reasoning behind its introduction. And let me tell you at upfront, these are introduced by virtue of recommendations under BEPS Action Plan 2, Hybrid Entities. Second, this is also part of multilateral instrument. So let's see what are the what does this clause really say. For the purposes of this convention, income derived by or through an entity or arrangement that is treated as wholly or partly fiscally transparent under the tax law of either contracting state shall be considered to be income of a resident of a contracting state, but only to the extent that the income is treated for purposes of taxation by that state as the income of a resident of that state. Oh my God, this is very jugglery, right? You really cannot understand anything out of it. Let's read once more and let's see if you could understand. Otherwise, I'm there to help you out always. So for the purposes of this convention, okay, got it. Income derived by or through an entity or arrangement. Okay, so there is some income which is derived by derived by or through an entity that is treated as wholly or partly fiscally transparent. What is treated as wholly or partly fiscally transparent? Entity or arrangement. Under the tax law of either contracting state, okay, shall be considered to be income of a resident of a contracting state, but only to the extent that the income is treated for the purposes of taxation by that state as the income of resident of that state. Now let me try to break this to make you understand. But before that, let me tell you two more important things. First, there's always a confusion with regard to the terms contracting state and other contracting state. Now, you would say that international tax is something which involves domestic tax law and the tax treaties we had learned in the very first class. But what makes international tax law different from our domestic tax system? The reason is that domestic tax system uses kind of different language and which the courts have interpreted, where there are always clarifications. But under international tax law, which is a public international law, the language is kind of little bit different. Why is it different? Because it's a kind of agreement between two states. It's not an act, okay? And here there are different interpretations by both the states. Why this contracting state term is used and not, why not the particular name of the country which are entering into treaty? Because the convention is applied by both the states, okay? So say for example, India-US double tax avoidance agreement. There, the convention, the DTAA is entered into by India as well as USA, and both will interpret it from their own perspective. So the term contracting state, which I would say, which is there, and the term other contracting state, you have to replace them with India and USA in the context with which you are using it. Okay, so if India is a residence country, like if India is a residence country of the taxpayer and is interpreting from that particular perspective, it will use the term contracting state wherever the term residence is being used. Okay, if India is a source country, if India is a source or a place of accrual of income, then in that particular case, it will use the term contracting state in the context of wherever the source or accrued term is being used. Okay, so you have to understand it from the perspective. We would be dealing with it while we are dealing with the treaty articles, but time being, this is the kind of thing how you have to use it. So I'll give you the examples as and when we use it. Or if you want now, I can take one example. Let's take maybe say Article 10. We take Article 10 to understand. So let's see. Say for example, I am resident of India. I am earning some dividend income from a company incorporated in USA. So India is a resident country, USA is the source country, and I am interpreting it from India's perspective. So how you would interchange the term contracting and other contracting state to avoid the confusion. So dividend paid by a company which is a resident of, is it a resident of India? No, it's a resident of USA. So here the contracting state, the context requires it to be changed with USA, because here, so there is no clear-cut answer where you have to change India, where you have to change US. But you have to read in the line with the context. So where a company is resident, US. So you will put US therein. To a resident of the other contracting state. So whom dividend is being paid? To me. Who is a resident of which country? India. So other contracting state here will mean India. May be taxed in that other state, which is India. Clear? Let's read the second part. However, dividends paid by a company which is a resident of which country? US. may also be taxed in that state, means US, according to the laws of that state, as in US. But if the beneficial owner of the dividend is a resident of other contracting state, who is the beneficial owner? I. Other contracting state would mean India. The tax or charge shall not exceed 5%. So did you get it clear? Like how you have to change it? We would be learning these examples every now and then. But just I just wanted to clarify the very outset of getting into DTAA. Next, before we understand now Article 1-2, before I break it down into parts, I would like to explain you the rationale of introducing this, and then we would interpret like why this particular clause is added and what is the real meaning of this particular clause. So let me tell you very first thing, just one second. Okay. So if you know about these partnerships or limited liability corporations, there is always a kind of litigation surrounding these. Why this is so? So I'm not touching upon at present on this fiscally transparent entities because we would be devoting an entire lecture on that separately. But what I wanted to do here is we wanted to understand Article 1-2. So that's why it is very important to understand why these things are like that. And in the upcoming classes, we would be dealing it in a greater detail. So this fiscally transparent entities we would be dealing while we are dealing Article 1-2. And then we would be touching upon it while we would be dealing with Article 23. So these are the two places where I would be referring to this fiscally transparent entities, and then under Article 4 also. So partnerships or limited liability corporations, in India, we treat them as a separate person under the domestic tax law. But you will say that right now I just mentioned that we don't have to resort to domestic tax law meaning of the term person. Yes, the answer is correct. I'm not resorting to the domestic tax law definition. I'm just telling you that these limited liability partnerships or the general partnerships which we have under India are treated as separate persons. The tax liability is payable by these particular partnerships. The tax is assessed in the hands of partnership and the profits are exempt in the hands of partners. But there are certain countries like USA. There are certain countries like Dubai, UAE, where these limited liability corporations are treated as transparent. What do I mean by the term fiscally transparent? So the profits of the partnership are not assessed in the hands of the partnership firm or limited liability partnerships, but in the hands of the partners. So these are the kind of pass-through entities. From Indian context, if I give you the example of pass-through entities, it's real estate investment trust, the REITs. It is alternate investment funds. Then it is trust, which are there, the private trust which we have. These are all the pass-through entities where the taxation does not happen in the hands of these entities, but in the hands of the investors. So similarly, these limited liability corporations are not treated as taxable entities, but the transparent entities. So the other term for taxable entities is opaque. The other term for these taxable entities, what they are called is opaque entities, because they are considered as taxable. For the limited liability corporations, which are not taxable, having the tax in their hands, they are known as the transparent entities, fiscally transparent entities, or hybrid entities. Why they are called as hybrid entities? Because there's a reason to it. Now, say for example, let me take one example. Suppose there is a US LLC, right? It earns some interest on loan from India. Now, as per India, this LLC, because under Indian law, the definition of person covers the partnerships, limited liability partnerships, companies, body corporates, okay, and association of persons. So what India would do is, from its perspective, India would try to think, this US LLC, what characteristics it has. So whether the profits are accessible in the hands of the partners, how, whether it has a separate entity, whether it's a separate entity different from its partners, whether it has a separate identity. So it will compare the characteristics with its kind of entity. If it feels that though US treats it as transparent and US assesses the tax in the hands of the investors rather than the particular entity, it will compare the other characteristics of these entities, that whether it has a separate identity, whether it has the shareholders, whether it is comparable to a corporate structure in India, or whether it's an association of person, how it can be classified. Okay, so if India feels that it can be classified as association of person, India will regard it as taxable entity. So under Indian laws, this particular entity would be considered as taxable. As per US, this will be considered as transparent. Right? So in one country, this is taxable. In other country, this is considered as transparent. Therefore, it is called as hybrid entity, because it is considered in one country as taxable and another country as transparent. And that is why it's in hybrid in nature. Now you would say that, ma'am, you said that we don't have to refer to definition of person under the domestic tax law. We have to refer to the definition of person under the DTAA. You're right. As per the DTAA, this particular entity would be person. No doubt about it. Even India would regard it as person. But while taxing this interest income, since under the domestic tax law, there are different rates for different kind of entities. Say, for example, the partnerships have 30% rate. The companies have 40% rate. So what kind of entity this is, whether it's a foreign company, whether it's foreign association of person, because then the taxation would differ. So India, under its domestic tax law, to assess the rate of tax, it will take what kind of entity it is. Okay. And also from the perspective that India would want to characterize this entity to determine how the profits are to be computed. Okay. Because if it's a transparent, it is assessed in the hands. If India also considers it as trust, then the profits would be assessed in the hands of the investors and not at the level of entity. But if India considers it as association of person or company, then India would say that the characteristics are similar to association of person, and therefore it should be taxable in the hands of the company and not at the level of investors. So for that purpose, since that mechanism is not given by DTAA, we have to resort to the domestic tax law. Because what DTAA does is, it just gives the allocation of rights. It doesn't define how you have to compute the tax or how you have to compute the income after giving some deductions. It doesn't lay down anything. It just says that which country has what taxing right, whether the source country has taxing right or not. It just specifies that. It doesn't lay down any computation mechanism. For that, you have to resort to domestic tax law. So of course, for purpose of determining that, India would refer to its definition of person to identify the characteristics of this entity and to determine the taxation rate. So that is one thing. Okay. So because of the differences in the domestic tax law of the two states, because of differences in characterization under two states, these entities are regarded as hybrid, because they are not classified as same under the laws of both the states. Now, the other issue which arises is these kind of partnerships, since these are not taxable or assessed to tax in their hands, the profits are passed on to the investors, they are not considered as liable to tax in certain jurisdiction, because they are themselves not liable to tax. And who is liable to tax? Are the investors. Now, if I refer at this point in time, the definition of Article 4, residency. Why I am referring to the definition of residency? Because who is person covered? we saw the definition of person. So as per suppose DTAA, this entity gets characterized as either company or body corporate, it gets classified as person. So the first step is fulfilled. But we have to refer to the second step, which is the term resident. That's why I'm referring to the definition of residency under Article 4. Now, if you see the definition of residency, what does it say is, for the purposes of this convention, the term resident of a contracting state means any person who under the laws of that state is liable to tax therein. So the issue arises whether these kind of partnerships are liable to tax. So OECD says these kind of partnerships are not liable to tax. Therefore, these may not get classified as residents. Clear? So they may be classified as persons, but they may not be classified as residents. And therefore, what would happen is that these partnerships or limited liability corporations would not get the benefit under DTAA. And there would be double taxation. How there would be double taxation? Because what will happen is India will say that these are transparent entities. These are not residents of the US because they are not liable to tax in US. And therefore, India will not give them the lower rate of tax under Article 11 of India-US DTAA. So India will impose tax at say 40%. US will say, I am the resident country. Say US has a tax rate of 21%. But US will not give credit of this 40%. Why it will not give the credit of 40%? Because it will say that the tax has been deducted first thing in the name of the US LLC in India. And I am putting this tax in the hands of investors. Right? So I'm not taxing in the hands of the company, but in the hands of investors. And the credit of the source country, credit of tax, which is deducted in source country, is reflected in the hands of US LLC. So there is a difference in the treatment under both the states. How? So say, for example, if I have the tax credit form from India of the taxes deducted, the taxpayer under whose name tax would be deducted would be this US LLC. How the investors can get credit of those taxes? There is no indirect credit mechanism under DTAA or under the domestic tax law of any state that tax deducted in name of some other person can credit it to me. The answer is no. Second, US would say that even if say I say give the indirect tax credit to the investors, but the taxation is not in accordance with convention, because US would say that as per DTAA, India should have restricted its taxing right up to 10% under Article 11. It has deducted at 40%. So I'm not going to wipe off my 21% and give away the tax to India. Clear? Because what US will have to do? US will have to deduct from this 21% the 40%, and you cannot obtain refund of the taxes paid in source country. So clearly, it is going to give a very kind of hardship to the taxpayers. Clear? So I'll give you a note on this before we proceed further now. So just write down. The general partnerships or limited liability corporations are in some countries treated as passed through or transparent entities. That is, the profits are taxable in the hands of the investors and not the corporation. Or you can just write not the entity. Whereas in other countries, these entities are treated as taxable or opaque. The profits of which are taxable in the hands of entity due to differences in characterization of an entity under the tax law of two states these kind of entities pose challenges as they are treated as taxable in one state and transparent in another. Therefore, they are also known as hybrid entities. Though the partnerships can be characterized as person under Article 3 as they can be either classified as company or non-profit, but they may not be considered as a resident as per Article 4. As these entities are not liable to tax in their own capacity. Which is one of the requirements of Article 4. Therefore, they may not be eligible to claim treaty benefit. Accordingly, the source state may not restrict its taxing right under the treaty and the resident state may not give relief of taxes paid in source state as the taxation in source state is not in accordance with convention. Further, the source state where it considers entity as taxable and resident state where it considers entity as transparent may tax different taxpayers, which will result in energy problem of claiming credit. As taxation is in hands of different persons. Economic double taxation, which is not relieved by the government. Clear? So as I told you in the earlier classes, that economic double taxation is not really relieved by the government. So this is what we are seeing right now. So if you could write down just this. Clear? Now, what is happening is there is a problem of double taxation which we saw. Also, these kind of entities are being used, especially from US perspective, so as to have double non-taxation. Because what will happen is in the one state, the profits are allocated of the entity to the taxpayer, to the investor. And in the other state, the profits are allocated to the entity and not to the particular investor. So there was double non-taxation also happening by virtue of using these kind of entities. So US has kind of a system which is called as check the box system. What does it mean? That there, these kind of entities can elect to choose themselves as to be treated as transparent and not as taxable persons. And these kind of entities are interposed in between to claim these double non-taxation benefits. So what is this regime called as? Check the box. So this is a US regime which allows the entity to treat themselves as transparent and not taxable. So say for example,